Okay, so the topic today is the 1965 Pearl versus Father Ryan basketball game, which was a significant event in Nashville history, but also the history of the South. I know that in talking to Frederick Strobel, who does a lot of work for Father Ryan, that they call this the game that changed the South. And it wasn't just the first integrated basketball game in Nashville history, but really in the entire South, January 4th, 1965. And it's interesting, there's so many interesting parts of Perry Wallace's life that this didn't even come up in the overview discussion yesterday. But in doing the research for the book, it was incredibly interesting to read about how significant this ball game was. And did any of you attend the game who are here in the room today? Besides the players that played for the teams. Clarice was there as a Pearl student. And would you like, okay, Mr. Dempsey, Lynn Dempsey made the game-winning shot, which we'll get to in a second. But when she realized that he was sitting right there, what did you tell me earlier today? So hopefully you'll make it out of this room okay, Lynn. Thank you for coming. So what we're going to do today is I'm going to read a little bit from the book that sort of set the stage for this game. We're going to play a video that Father Ryan produced on the occasion of the 50th anniversary of this historic game when the Pearl Cone basketball team played against Father Ryan at Municipal Auditorium, same gym where this historic game was played. And then Lynn Dempsey, who made the game-winning shot for Father Ryan, is here. And his teammate, Don Craighead, from Father Ryan, is here. And we'll hear about their experience growing up in Nashville, how they ended up at the school, and their memories of this historic game. And then next week, as you know, we're taking a field trip over to the old Pearl High School building, which is now MLK Magnet School. And we'll have a chance to hear from Melvin Black, who was a coach on that Pearl team, about the other side of the story, and then also have a chance to tour the museum and archives that they have, which is just tremendous, with pictures from Pearl. You know, it was the only school in Nashville for African Americans for over 60, 70 years. And so you'll see pictures dating back to the 1890s of the students there. It's just amazing. And then also trophies from the many state championships, band uniforms, paintings of Perry Wallace and other students, and hear about the history of that school, which is so important to Nashville history. So in 1954, when Brown versus Board came along, Father Ryan was the first school in Nashville to integrate. You know, they didn't wait for sort of the Nashville plan, which came along and integrated the public schools in town. The school went ahead and integrated right away in 1954. It was about 10 years later, in the 63-64 school year, that the athletic teams at Father Ryan were integrated. And Don, you were among the first, is that right? Or did you come along the next year? The next year. And so Coach Derek, the basketball coach at Father Ryan, called Cornelius Ridley, who was the coach at Pearl, and suggested that these schools play a historic basketball game. Father Ryan had already played against integrated football teams from the state of Kentucky before this basketball game came along. So the school was already making certain strides. They were looking to play against other NIL schools for a while, who said that they wouldn't play against Father Ryan if they had black players on the team. But finally they said, you know, we're going to go ahead and do this anyway in 1963-64, and none of the games were canceled as those white schools had threatened. So the anticipation for this ball game was just incredible. And talking to Father Ryan and Pearl players and doing the research for the book, you know, players telling me that everywhere they went around town in Nashville, people just could not wait for this game to be played. The crowd was expected to be so big that they weren't going to be able to fit it in either of the school's gyms. And Memorial Gym at Vanderbilt hadn't been expanded yet, so it wasn't even big enough to host this game. And so the game was played at Municipal Auditorium, which then was sort of the jewel of auditoriums in Nashville. And thankfully it's still around, and they were able to play the reunion game there last year. But I'll just sort of read a section from the book and set the stage for this ball game. And I forgot my glasses. No sooner had the first game between a black and predominantly white school been scheduled for January 4th, 1965, then it became the most highly anticipated basketball game in Nashville history. As players and coaches from both teams enjoyed some time off from school over the Christmas holiday, they were bombarded with questions from friends and neighbors about the historic game. Tony Moorman, the Pearl forward, couldn't escape the hype anywhere. Even at church, he said, all anyone wanted to talk about was the Ryan game. Even the sermons touched on the game. All this was taking place during one of the most intense periods of the civil rights movement. Just a year and a half earlier, the 16th Street Baptist Church in Birmingham had been bombed, killing four young black girls. 6 months earlier, President Johnson had signed the Civil Rights Act. 5 months earlier, civil rights workers James Chaney, Andrew Goodman, and Michael Schwerner, one black, two white, were killed by Klan members in Neshoba County, Mississippi. 1 month after the game, Malcolm X would be shot down in New York. 2 months later, the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma, Alabama would be the site of the Bloody Sunday attacks on peaceful protesters. 7 months later, President Johnson would sign the Voting Rights Act, and riots in the Watts section of Los Angeles would set the city ablaze. So you can see the context of this basketball game, bringing white kids and black kids and fans together. There was sense of trepidation about what might happen when you had these fans coming together in the same building for the game. And then I'll talk about the game day itself. January 4th, 1965, game day. In Washington, D.C., President Johnson delivered his State of the Union address, talking to the nation about a great society, the iconic agenda that spawned programs to improve public health, protect the environment, fight poverty, support the arts, and combat institutionalized racism. In downtown Nashville, Memphis attorney A.W. Wills Jr. walked into the state capitol and took his seat at a rickety old desk, becoming the first black since Reconstruction to serve in the Tennessee General Assembly. And just a few blocks away at Municipal Auditorium, the gates to history opened at 6 o'clock, fans from both schools flooding into the arena with their $1.25 general admission tickets. So many of them coming in so fast that the doors would have to be locked before tip-off. It was the junior varsity players from Pearl and Ryan who actually made history first on this night, since their 6:30 p.m. game preceded the main attraction. As fans by the thousands scrambled to find the best seats, the kids who weren't yet good enough to make the varsity suddenly found themselves playing ball in front of more than 8,000 people. I remember coming out onto the court for the fourth quarter of our game, Pearl JV forward Tony Moorman recalled, and it seemed like there were 2 million people in there. We'd make a basket and our fans would erupt so loud you'd hear the ringing in your ears. Then they'd make a basket and their side would erupt. It was a first for both teams to see that many people at a game. As usual, Pearl's varsity squad put on their high-flying whoomp show, Dunkathon, during halftime of the JV game, bringing the Tiger fans to their feet and nearly sending Father Ryan, varsity center Robert Fort, who had poked his head out of the locker room to see what the noise was all about, into cardiac arrest when he mistook the Pearl varsity for the JV. I thought, if this is the B team, we don't have a chance, he said. Both junior varsity teams played tight with so many eyes watching their every move, but the Pearl JVs ended up winning the game easily. And then after brief remarks by the principals of both schools, it was time for the main event, the first of 63 high school basketball games in Nashville that week, but the only one that mattered. And so the game begins, and as I mentioned, is Frederick in the room yet? Frederick Strobel has put together this video. Brooke, you probably helped with this video as well. And it's a nice recap of that ball game and also of the 50th reunion game. And then after the video, I'll call Lynn and Don up and we'll begin the Q&A.
Segregation was the order of the day.
We were just in trouble times.
People were separate, lived separate from each other, had misconceptions about each other.
Really, we didn't know what it was going to be like. It had never been like it, like anything we were going to see.
And so a game like this was going to loom larger than being just a sports event between two very, very fine teams.
My name is Walter Fisher, Sr. I played on the 64, 65, and 66 state championship team at Pearl High.
My name is Perry Wallace. I played basketball at Pearl High School from 1963 to 1966 in Nashville, Tennessee.
I'm Coach Bill Derrick, and I coached at Paul Ryan from 1958 to 1984.
The electricity that night in that gym, it was so thick you could cut it with a knife. If the fire marshal had came through there, he would have shut the whole place down.
Big buzz, because it was clearly historic.
There were so many people that got there that evening that they had to lock the doors. They couldn't let anybody else in.
Here was going to be a formal game played in a large arena to a packed crowd.
First opportunity, I think, that I ever had a chance to play against a white team.
There was a very strong element of the unknown.
Those guys opened that door, a door that we walked through to make more history. We was on the cutting edge of slashing that civil rights thing. On the cutting edge of... They wasn't doing it in Mississippi. They wasn't doing it in Georgia. They wasn't doing it nowhere.
Everyone wants to leave a lasting impression and make a contribution to society, and these young men were able to do that, you know, through a children's game. Well, I'm looking at the actual game program from the historic game, and you see my uncle's name here at the top for Pearl High, Perry Wallace, being a part of something so historic for the city of Nashville, which is very moving. So to be able to see here, be here and witness all this.
And today we are in the Civil Rights Room. The room has been open 11 years now, and it highlights Nashville's role during the modern Civil Rights Movement.
It was packed with 8,300 people this year.
And it's fitting that we're here today in this room because we're honoring the 50th anniversary of the Colonel Father Ryan Gay, looking at how Nashville changed sports, how schools were integrated, and what Father Ryan did to change the face of segregation in our city.
Nashville was the perfect place for this to happen, and I believe because of the number of universities here in Nashville, people came from all over the world, and I think that influenced the society in Nashville, and Nashville was a little bit more liberal than other southern cities.
Now I think we have to identify what does that mean for us today, not here just in Nashville, but that we can help those in Ferguson and New York and other places come to a better understanding that we're all created in God's eye.
You know, work hard, play hard, have a lot of fun, but be smart.
One, two, three.
No parts of the South was they integrated, but they came through Nashville, and Nashville put them on the map with that. Yes, we can, yes, we will, and we did that.
Our coaches and our principal came together and started meeting with Pearl and laying the groundwork for what was to be a new era in sports.
Of course, it was going to take people and their leaders deciding to find ways of having blacks and whites to function together.
And you got to understand, by Pearl being basically the only black high school in North Nashville, it was very sensitive about that high school.
We wanted to demonstrate that we were good enough to play in the larger system.
We were excited about it, and boy, Pearl, they beat everybody they play, and they had just won a national championship.
This is not just about doing a nice deed for some poor little people on the other side of town. Is that there's some people on the other side of town who can ball.
They're doing the half of the junior varsity game. The senior varsity for Pearl came out and started warming up and shooting.
We had to maneuver ourselves to the crowd. It was just like this.
And all those players came out there, and boy, every one of them were dunkers.
Woody Fisher let us out. And instead of him going, laying it up, he threw it down. The gym erupted.
Everybody in the whole gymnasium was going, whoo, whoo.
Milton Smith came behind him, and then it went on and on and on.
We thought about going home.
I just know that it was magic, it was exciting, and it's almost as if the earth stood still.
Willie Brown was our hero. Willie Brown scored 21 points in that game. He was the highest scorer for any team. One of the finest young men I think I have ever seen and have ever coached. We were prepared for our zone press defense. We had managed to stay with them. It was anybody's game at the time.
When Pearl make a basket, all right. When Ryan made a basket, all right. So evidently, from what I can understand, there was no type of miscommunications on who's cheering for who or who's cheering for that.
We got the ball, went down, and held the ball for a while to run the clock down.
Well, that shot was supposed to have been made by Wade, but for some reason it came off.
Close, but didn't go in. But Len Dempsey got the rebound.
It was in the right place at the right time.
Put it back up, and the dadgum ball went in.
Perfect jump shot. It was pretty, to say the least.
And we beat them 52-51, and the gymnasium went crazy.
It is what it is. Father Ryan beat us, and that's that.
That game played a nice little role in moving things forward in that difficult arena of getting people together, getting the races together around things that are really good and really important.
We went through that year, the rest of that year, and the whole year of '66 with a lot of dignity and pride. Really told us that you're going to be on spotlight. You know, you're going to be on spotlight. We've got to maintain and stay focused. And we'll forget that.
How you doing?
Okay, how are you?
Good. Okay, you sitting on the floor in this open seating.
I was there in this original.
You were?
Yes.
Wow. Tonight is the 50th anniversary of the Father Ryan Pearl Cone basketball game.
Finish, Mike! Finish, Mike!
Tonight, as I enter the municipal auditorium, I'm pretty sure the ghosts of the Father Ryan Pearl gang will come back, and then I'll get a little better perspective at that time.
The funniest thing is nothing's changed. Nothing's changed. We've all gotten better looking. We've done it. Nothing's changed.
From the moment the doors open on that memorable Monday night, so Father Ryan's Len Dempsey arched his 15-foot jumper over the outstretched arm of Pearl, history was made with each second played. We are honored to salute the memories of these two teams and that great night.
This is the best nostalgia in town because it's nostalgia about a wonderful moment where people made more sense than people had been making.
What is 50 years ago? And look what's going on, look what's happening. We're still talking about it.
And what we did in that arena was something that was really grand.
Since the video started, Frederick has come in there. And so Frederick and Brooke, thank you so much for putting this wonderful piece of history together. Okay, and with that, I would love to invite Lynn Dempsey and Don Craighead to come up and join me on the stage. Two members of the Father Ryan team from that year. And you can clip that on. Thank you, guys. see who can get their microphone on first. All right, you good? It's a small room. Okay, Lynn, you made a game-winning shot. Getting the rebound and making the shot probably took 1 or 2 seconds, right? In 1965, yep. So over 50 years ago. How has that 2 seconds of your life continued to sort of reappear in your life since then?
Here we are 52 years later. I've heard about it. We were talking, Don and I, earlier. I travel quite a bit for business, not as much as I used to, but just in the United States. But people that I didn't know from school, some that I did, and always running into different people, and that subject comes up. Now, my poor children had to live through this. And my wife and my kids just go, oh, just walk off. But, you know, you talk about the 10 minutes of fame thing, you know, so my, 10 seconds, I guess we would say, because I couldn't rebound and take a shot. I had to put the ball down for at least one dribble. And Coach Derek was up my shirt my whole time playing varsity basketball, Ryan, about that. But I did that, so it was probably 4 seconds or so.
Okay. Sorry.
All I remember was moving to the left, going up, because Perry Wallace looked like a skyscraper coming down. And he was a big man at that time, 6'5", 6'6", and that was a big man in high school basketball back in those days. Willie Brown was our tallest, probably Robert Ford, I guess, 6'3", 6'4". But Willie had the capacity to, you know, touch the ceiling anyway. But it's just been one of those things, and people will talk about how it changed their perception about life, about integration, racial tensions, the racial divide, because we were right in the heart of it. But you have to understand, as 17 and 18 year old kids, we knew, and I said this on film several times, that it was a big, big game, no doubt about it. You heard, you know, the comments. But we didn't really understand the depth of what was really going on, what was really behind it, until years later. It was never discussed. It never really came up. I don't remember in my household growing up after that and moving on. It was just a big game. Luckily, somehow we won it. Walter Fisher, who you saw was a leading scorer for Pearl, did not score 1 point in that game. But it was just the adrenaline, and as I said, I was the right place at the right time, and it went in. Only 2 points I scored, by the way. So that's my story at this point anyway. I was in the game quite a bit, but Pat Sanders, who could not be with us today, had fouled out, and he left me a voicemail when he found out he was not going to be able to make this event today, because he's usually always with us. It's been a thorn in his side because he fouled out and that wasn't him making that shot. 52 years, he has never gotten it open. I have this ongoing rambling voicemail from him because I wasn't about to take his call. Now, you just remember when you get up on that stage that I scored 9 points, but Willie was the only one that had double figures on our team, okay? Perry Wallace scored 13 and for Pearl, but Willie was the man. But Pat said, you know, I was 5 of 7 from the free throw line. He said 7 of 8, but it was 5 of 7. And he had his 9 points, and he said, I actually blocked 2 of Walter Fisher's shots during that game. You make sure somehow this came out, so I have witnesses. We maybe reconvene for the 75th anniversary. and we roll Pat in here, then you know, somebody tell him that for you, so, okay?
Okay. Well, after that answer, I think it is time for the 75th anniversary now.
And I have a little above my playing weight back in those days.
No. Don, so your father owned a barbershop on Jefferson Street, not too far from Pearl High School. What was your perspective coming into this game? I know, you know, we've talked about Willie Brown, who is African-American player for Father Ryan, the star of that team, grew up with most of the players on the Pearl team. His girlfriend was the captain of the Pearl High cheerleaders, so there are quite interesting relationships between both teams. What was your relationship with Pearl High School and the players on the Pearl team?
Well, I, being Catholic, being raised Catholic, I was always in the Catholic school, so I didn't have a whole lot of contact with Pearl players. And I knew them, but just didn't have a whole lot of contact with them growing up. You mentioned about Dad's barbershop. The NBC did a white paper in 1960, and Common actually filmed at the barbershop. Because of all the racial activity that was going on in Nashville. The year prior, my sister had been arrested for sitting in a lunch counter. And so the issue of race came to me early on, actually back when Brown versus the Board of Education, Topeka, Kansas, 1954. And at that point in my life, I realized that the way I looked had a different impact. Although I was, that issue didn't come up in the family, it's just it couldn't be bypassed because things kept happening like that. So I was in the barbershop the night that was filmed, and it wasn't some kind of special event that the Craighead family would be involved in this. My dad's barbershop was the only one open at the time that NBC was looking for a local business to talk about these particular issues. So, and I was behind the screen that whole time. It went to about 1 a.m. Wow. And only, I think the film itself is only about, the segment is only about 4 or 5 minutes at the most.
Wow. Have you all seen that white paper? You can watch it down at the Civil Rights Room at the National Public Library downtown. A landmark piece of television journalism for that era. Was it Chet Huntley, was the narrator for that, talking about the sit-ins and sort of views on race from African-Americans and white Nashvillians at that time. It's a really interesting snapshot of this city, of that era. So your sister was one of the lunch counter sit-ins. Can you tell us more about that?
She was, well, she's 8 years older than I am. I just turned 69, so she was at Tennessee State University. And some of the students there decided that they would participate in what was happening in the city downtown. And so she was part one of those groups that was arrested early on in that process.
Mm-hmm. And Lynn, growing up white in Nashville, what was your experience with segregation? And were you paying attention to that as a kid?
In a way, you paid attention. You heard the subject in discussions come up. You saw the news footage of things that were going on. As far as discussion in our house, there was never a racial issue as far as we were concerned. And as far as the environment at Father Ryan from the freshman year, when I started in 61, I was also Catholic, and Catholic in those days, when you went to parochial schools, I lived in the Donaldson Hermitage area, grew up in that area, in Holy Rosary Parish. And you just went to Ryan if you were a boy. If you were a girl, you went to St. Bernard, St. Cecilia. You know, if your family could afford to put you there, which they would always try to scrape and struggle to make sure that you got a Catholic education, that was just kind of understood. But as far as the race, it was never an issue for my family or for a lot of us at Ryan. There were some tensions, if you would, but you know, that's part of how you were raised. So I was fortunate in the respect that was never an issue. You never said some of those choice words. Believe me, and my father was a big man, and he would hurt you. Would really hurt you. You usually just give me a look and I could turn the stone right then, you know, he didn't have to raise his hand. But you were aware of what was going on. You heard about it. You knew the situation downtown that was strictly off limits for us. No ifs, ands, or buts. And I know some of my buddies, you know, would get a bus, you know, if we didn't have cars, which most of us didn't at that time. You would, you know, catch a bus, go downtown. You didn't really want to get too close, but too close to what? You never knew when something was going to happen. But you saw it, you heard about it, you knew what was going on, you didn't really understand it. That's why I say the significance of that game went so much, much deeper. But as young people, kids basically, it was girls, maybe academics, girls, maybe sports, and girls. Pretty much in that order. You know? But that's where you were focused, but still, it was just a big game, you know, and if you can picture us walking into that auditorium, and it was just mind-boggling, absolutely mind-boggling. Our gym at the old Father Ryan High School on Elliston Place, right down the street, just one side of the gym with bleachers, maybe held 500 people, maybe, and that was packed to the rafters. So when they talked about none of the gyms being big enough, the Vanderbilt gym not being big enough, but to walk out there and, like the band from Pearl Team said, you know, it looked about like 2 million people, honestly. And it was just an unbelievable experience. I'm very glad I was there.
And Don, what are the considerations for your family in sending you to the segregated black Catholic elementary school, right, and middle school, and then you arrive at Father Ryan? I know when Perry made the decision to go to college, at Vanderbilt, there was some tensions even within his own family. His sister, Jessie, said she would have preferred that he had gone to an HBCU and gone to TSU or Fisk like she and her sisters had done. He had some friends and family that were, you know, proud that he was helping to integrate Vanderbilt and he would be going to a good school, whereas others, you know, had some resentment or would call him a sellout, you know, even for going to Vanderbilt. Did you experience those same kinds of reactions?
No, not at all. Again, being raised Catholic, the idea that we would go to a school, non-Catholic school, just didn't exist in our family. My sisters had gone to Cathedral High School and it was integrated, so this would have been in the mid-50s. The two older brothers had gone to Father Ryan, that was, and they had finished by 1960, and I came in 61. So that was just expected. And I, you know, as a result of the 50th anniversary and all the events that occurred, you know, a year and a half or so ago, I've thought about if I had any fear about an all predominantly white school playing a black school in the middle 60s in Nashville, Tennessee, in the South. I must admit, I did have some fear. But it wasn't race related. Knowing how Pearl played basketball was intimidating. But there was I had no sense that there would be something that would go wrong because you and I have a different color skin. And maybe it was just our youth and immaturity and when he talked about girls. And, it just wasn't an issue fear-wise. But we were concerned about Pearl because they were an awesome basketball team. Mm-hmm.
And we can't talk about that game without acknowledging Willie Brown.
Oh,
this
yes.
Star player for the Father Ryan team, as I mentioned, had grown up with the Pearl players. He passed away, so he's not able to tell the story himself. But by all accounts, just a wonderful person, great student, great athlete. Can both of you share some memories of Willie Brown? And by the way, Willie Brown later became the first African-American basketball player at MTSU. And being a year older than Perry Wallace, Perry said that Willie sort of talked to him about what that pioneering experience was like for him and was a mentor in a way to him.
One of the things that I didn't know this at the time, I was with Willie in grade school, so from kindergarten to eighth grade at St. Vincent de Paul, and then we would graduate and then go to Father Ryan. But I would later learn that we would ride the bus home, catch it at West End, just near Vanderbilt, headed home to North Nashville. All he wanted to do was to play basketball. And the idea, and it was problematic, the idea that he would be going to Father Ryan when minorities were not allowed to play, or they could be on the team, but they wouldn't be able, their team couldn't play any other teams within the city, the league. And so that was a battle in his home about where to go to school. And if he had the opportunity, he would have gone to Pearl High. But his dad took that opportunity, but no, you're going to Father Ryan. And things just, you know, his junior year, it was our junior year, 1964, when that opened up and it all changed. And he and, I don't know if you remember, Jesse Porter, he was talking at the library. He and Jesse Porter were the first two minorities to play at Father Ryan basketball. So,
So your first 2 years there, you could be a student, but you couldn't play on the basketball team, not till your junior year.
Correct.
Okay. And Lynn, what kind of guy was Willie? What are your memories of Willie Brown?
Willie, the type of basketball player he was, very talented, a lot of natural talent, but he was also very coachable. And he just had a gift that you even recognized being a youngster, to the point that when he couldn't play, we had, I will say, like a recess period, for lack of a better word, after the lunch break at school. And you could go in the gym and a lot of guys would play pickup games. Well, most of the school would congregate in the gym just to watch Willie play a pickup game. And, you know, he was just...
Is this before he was allowed to play on the varsity?
Exactly. Yeah. And you just knew. You know, so then when the time came, and he actually was the captain of our basketball team. That's how well thought of he was. When you heard Coach Derrick talk about him being a fine young man and a good athlete, you know, that was a fact. Very, very humble, very soft-spoken, and he let himself do his big talking on the basketball court. But 21 points against that team when they knew his reputation, just like we knew their reputation. They didn't care about any of the rest of us, but they knew Willie. We were not a threat, okay? Willie was a threat. So in spite of all their best efforts defensively, they couldn't shut him down. And he really should have had that last shot, and he just did miss it, as I say. So that was not a scripted play, I will be honest and tell you that. I actually thought, you know, it was probably one of Coach Derrick's best coaching moves when he put me in. Which still feels Pat Sanders.
So, but you guys could see the stupidity of segregation every day at your school, where you had the very best, most talented player at your school. Everyone's sitting around watching him, and he wasn't allowed to be on the team.
Yep. I think that was a major irritation for Coach Derrick. He knew that talent was out there, but he couldn't make use of it. Reflecting on all of this over the years and then thinking about it, it occurred to me that because of the separation of the races, I think that we were really disadvantaged. And what brought it to mind was when Willie joined the team and began to play, I remember he would dunk the ball, you know, and nobody else on the team could dunk. He couldn't jump high enough, you know, and the old saying is, you know, white boys can't jump kind of thing. But I remember it was so inspiring to Marty Gilmore. He was a junior at the time. I was on the team then, so I was our senior year. And Marty would push himself to dunk. He was tall enough to do it, but by the fact that there was a player there who was jumping high enough to be able to dunk the ball, there were now other players who were pushing themselves to do even more being able to reach a higher potential than they'd ever played before. And so I think that was one of the benefits of integration in a strange way. Couldn't have anticipated that. That could have been anyone, but it just happened to have been a black player at the time who said, look, I can do this, you can do it too, just by the way he played the game.
Mm-hmm. That's very interesting. And what was everyday life like for you at this school as one of just a handful of African American students at Father Ryan?
It was high school.
No girls.
Yeah, boys high school. Yeah. So I don't know how to describe it. It was just high school. Had to go to class, and if I did anything wrong, you know, we could be paddled at the time. You talked about corporal punishment, my goodness. Mm-hmm. So it was serious business. We were there for an education. That was the purpose.
Yeah. Did you feel like you were pioneering in the classroom too at the time?
No, not really. It's just.
So what?
No, I didn't. I couldn't fathom it. Although all the other things that were going on, I was a teenager, early teens. I just wasn't smart enough. I didn't look out to know all that was happening. Mm-hmm.
Okay, and I'd love to hear both of you talk about Coach Derek as well, who was a progressive person, you know, and was scheduling these games against integrated teams from Kentucky, takes the lead in scheduling this game against Pearl. What can you share with us about the type of man that Coach Derek is and why he would have, he's still living, why he would have wanted to do this, take a chance? Why did he want to do this?
I would say that looking back on Coach Derek, he was a very principled man. Lived by a set of principles and stuck by them. And what brought that to light for me was it didn't matter how good we were. If we didn't do what he said to do on the court, he would bench us. And so just because you're a star player, you don't get to play and break the rules. You play by the rules, you'll get to play.
Mm-hmm.
You pretty much did what he said do. And I can remember like it was yesterday, the part of our practices, our significant part of our practices, was the running aspect, because we were not big kids. But we could run you from daylight to dark and not even breathe hard. You know, we finish a hard practice. Our gym was staggered, the half of the stands. We ran laps from the court up three flights of steps across the seating area, down three flights. 50, we'd start at 50, then you did sets of 10, wind sprints from one end of the court, then back was one. And you do sets of 10. And it was a conditioning, and basically, I will tell you, in this game, our defense, we prided ourselves on our defense. We ran a zone defense most of the time, for anybody that knows anything about basketball. Because if you tried to go man-to-man against Pearl, you were dead. But we were conditioned on the zone defense as well as a full-court press. To me, that's what won the game and the free throws. We knocked down the free throws when we had to make them. That was the difference in the game. And in fact, Walter Fisher never scored a point. If he'd have made one basket, we'd have lost. Okay? Walter will tell you himself. He told me. But it was a conditioning. But Coach Derek, 26 years of coaching there, was always well thought of, is still well thought of. It was just a privilege to play for him, but he did have a way of dressing you down, and he would never really embarrass you, you know. in front of the other guys, other than the fact that he would have you off the floor, carrying you off the court to talk to you. But he was just a great man. Always had the utmost respect for him. But it was his faith, and like Don said, his principles, I think, that drove him to try to get this game established. So it was a foresight there for whatever reason, and then Coach Ridley and Pearl thinking on the same wavelength. Mm-hmm. So it was just a combination of many, many amazing things that really brought it together. And of course, the impact is history, quite factually. Mm-hmm. So as I said, it was just a privilege to be a part of it. It really was. And to still hear about it, even though it still feels like it. Down with the kids.
Okay, well, just a couple more questions for me, then we'll open it up to the audience. But in talking to the Pearl players, and as I read from the book, they talked about just the anticipation for this game. It was the first game played after the Christmas holiday, so there were a couple weeks there where, you know, there was time for people to just be thinking and talking about this game. Do you remember that, the build-up to the game, and how much you were looking forward to this chance to play against Pearl?
Again, it was just about the fear. you know, would we make a decent showing? I guess that was the fear. The idea that we would come away as winners is bizarre. I mean, it just wasn't part of my thinking. Uh-huh. So I didn't give it much thought. I mean, you know, again, there we were, our senior year in high school, on a Christmas break. And so what much, I don't remember, did we practice anything? I remember us getting together, so it wasn't continuing to.
We were scattered all over Nashville. So that was your team time. We might have had one when we first came back to school, which had just been a couple of days before that game. But it was just something that you anticipated. But as I said, when you walked in there, you realized there was something a whole lot bigger than you going on. Mm-hmm. A whole lot bigger than you. One quick story I have to tell for my buddy Pat Sanders, because we both got in trouble. When they're running their drills with the whoosh, now imagine, of these 8,500 people, probably 8,000 were predominantly Pearl supporters. So when they dunked the ball, which they could all do, you know, you heard this whoosh, and it was deafening. I mean, the place would shake. So Pat and I, we're running our drills on our end of the court where, you know, you bite up and you run in, you get the pass and you lay it up and, you know, run around. Just regular drill. Well, Pat and I were standing at center court watching these guys. Our backs to what we were doing. And these guys, and I mean, and Pat's looking at me and I'm looking at him and thinking, oh, almighty, what are we going to do now? You know, whoosh. And then you hear this voice, Dempsey, Sanders. We turn around, it's Coach Derek, his face was just blood red. What are you doing out there? Oh, we didn't even realize, you know, that we had stuff going on. You know, we just sitting there going, oh, I'm done. So right off the bat, you know, we had his ringing in our ears. So, but it was just amazing to watch. Amazing.
No, that was at that 50th anniversary game. Such a well put together game, Frederick and Pat, and organizing and getting both teams together. I think just about every player from both teams that was still living was still there. And before the game, I noticed that the Pearl players and the Father Ryan players from 65 were all kind of mingling around together. And I was really surprised and impressed. I don't know how often you've seen each other, but it seemed like you guys were just greatest of old friends from both teams, sharing memories and talking to each other. I mean, it just struck me that Nashville was a smaller town back then, and you neither knew each other or knew of each other, and there was a real connection there, even between these two schools. Was I correct in that feeling I was picking up?
Yep. We didn't really, after we graduated, went to school, a lot of us, you know, it was back during the Vietnam era, a lot of us were in some branch of the service, and a lot of those guys I had not seen since that game, probably most of them, to be exact, even some of my own teammates, other than the ones that, as a class of 65, we have been probably one of the tightest-knit classes in the history of that school. We still get together. Of course, we're the age now. We're losing a lot more of them, unfortunately. And Willie, those of you who don't know, if I don't know if it was mentioned, he mentioned that he had passed away, but tragically, he was only 27 years of age. He was left Nashville after he left Middle Tennessee, which was State University at that time, State College rather, wasn't
okay.
University. But he was a patrol motorcycle police officer, state police officer in Connecticut. And it was an accident, motorcycle accident, that took his life. You know, he would be so proud of this and the legacy and the history. A very nice plaque dedicated in his memory at Father Ryan in the gym, and his basketball jersey, which he was pretty easy to pick up, you know, in the picture of us, you know, there in the front row, the number 50 there. It was retired by the school as part of that celebration, that 50th anniversary. So just a great guy, and you would know that if he were here. But, I mean, he's always been with us. He was one of the biggest factors of that. But it was just getting back together, and it was just like 1965 on mm-hmm. a different level.
Mm-hmm.
It was a lot of fun, a lot of fun, a lot of reminiscing.
And Don, your sister participated in civil rights and is arrested at the lunch counters. You participate in a way in this basketball game. I mean, people ask about the significance of sports, you know, and it's something that's addressed in the book, the role that sports plays in American culture, or specifically related to race relations. I mean, do you think that this game and its legacy is significant? Is it more than just a basketball game, or do we make too much of it?
Well, if you think about what the time period was, the tensions between the races, to have brought so many different races together, or I should say black and whites together under one roof, during a time which outside of that building we were not getting along very well. And nothing happened. Not a single event occurred that was race related as a result of that basketball game. Is extraordinary. Just the wrong kind of move as we're walking out of the, or stepping on a toe or something like that. Nothing happened. I don't know how to describe the how amazing that is under the circumstances. The time period, it was volatile. We didn't get along very well, and we made that public. Outside of the state, and I'm not just referring to the school itself, it's just that our citizens did not think it was important that we somehow should bridge the gap about race at the time.
Mm-hmm. Except for this lady, you heard her, she wouldn't do it.
Okay, but she couldn't get to you.
J.C. Hall was there, who was the principal at Pearl at the time, and nobody crossed him, so
What are your memories of being there for that game?
Oh, it was just extremely exciting, and everybody who was a student at Pearl or who had ever been a student at Pearl had to be there. Or if you just hung around the fringes of the school, you had to be there.
All right, so we've got about 20 minutes to take questions from all of you. So who would like to get us started? Yes, sir.
I assume an organization like SAA or some group like that made the rule that banned black kids from playing on sports teams. So what, historically, how did they move from something must have happened that they woke up and said, gee, this kind of stupid kids go to school and they can't play.
Mm-hmm. Well, one thing
I can tell I'm not from here. I'm from Jersey, so
they weren't going to school. The schools were not integrated.
Yeah.
Right.
I went to Hillsborough. I did not go to school with a black student my 4 years there.
And what year did you graduate from Hillsborough?
I graduated from Hillsborough in 59.
Uh-huh.
And I never went to school with a black student. So there was no problem with me playing all those sports teams. There were no students.
Mm-hmm. And so the TSSAA was the first state sports association in the South to bring the white schools and the black schools together. That wasn't until the 1965-66 season. And so that's the year that Pearl High School goes undefeated. The year after this game, they go undefeated and win the first state championship, where it's an integrated state championship. The announcement had already been made that that was coming. So this Father Ryan Pearl game is played the year before, when people know the next year the teams will be having the opportunity to play against each other. And so in some ways this was a precursor or a test case of how it would go. And Coach Ridley and Coach Derrick would have known that the leagues were merging the next year. Prior to that, Pearl would win state championships in Tennessee that were just in the black leagues in Tennessee. Yeah. Do you guys have anything to add to this? Do you know much about Father Ryan's efforts to play against other teams or other public schools in Nashville looking to play against Pearl?
I don't. No. We scrimmaged some teams that we didn't actually play during the season.
Okay.
But they were just scrimmage, like practice games, scrimmage games.
Yeah. Frederick?
Just to add to that, Andrew, Father Ryan integrated in 63 from Willie and Jesse DeCourt, and that was really the first step in integrating the TSSAA. It was the only school that had done that. Coach Derrick, to his everlasting credit, attended Austin schools, and we told him, literally, we're looking forward to coming to play you all. Just bring, or if you're coming over to play us, just bring your white boys over to play. And Coach Derrick said, you're going to play us, you aren't going to play us. If you're going to play everybody, you aren't going to play us at all.
Mm-hmm.
And there was that kind of pushback from some schools that didn't want this to take place. But it was clear that the 63 integration at Ryan made possible the 65 Ryan Pearl game, which made possible the 66 integration or combination of the black and white schools in the TSSAA. It moved in that particular direction. But then Billy Lynch will tell you that the same year Ryan played Pearl, there was a push to have West play Cameron over at Kingsville Garden. The idea was that there would be two games played, public and in some way private school, Father Ryan, public school West versus Cameron. And they just couldn't get that one done. There was too much resistance to that particular state. But there was a move going at that particular point. A lot of change was happening in this community. Was happening in the same way in the sports realm. And it's those stages that really brought it about.
Okay. Cameron being the other black high school in town at the time?
Mm-hmm. No.
Yes?
We're talking about the public schools, but I believe the university school had integrated even before Father Ryan.
The records show the Brown v. Board of Education decision was May of 54. Ryan integrated September of 54, the first time.
64, I'm sorry, I thought you said 64.
63 was the integration of sports.
Yeah,
54,
right.
Father Ryan integrated. Father Ryan and Cathedral High School were the first two schools to integrate in the state. And best we can tell in the South, just by the date, it's hard to determine what schools opened when. There were some North Carolina schools that might have it
okay.
at the same time.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Could you tell us about, you read about Perry's experience at Vanderbilt. What was your experience at Father Ryan?
Again, I was going to a high school. I was there to learn as much as I could and do well or suffer the consequences of my disciplinary parents. So it wasn't about being in a white school, it was about going to school.
Mm-hmm.
So I wasn't raised that way. It wasn't in my household. So I didn't bring it to high school. There was nothing to bring in terms of race. I knew that there was differences, but it didn't interfere with my high school. Mm-hmm. It's not where I lived inside.
And that your classmates, Perry felt at times a sense of isolation, and also at other times a sense of isolation in terms of loneliness, but also isolation in terms of all eyes on him.
Yeah. Oh, I can only imagine.
Mm-hmm.
Because he was playing in the Deep South, and it but how he, I also understand that he had some trouble at Vanderbilt itself.
Yes.
But within the team, I don't know that.
Right. I'm talking about isolation mainly just on campus, existing in the classroom or in his dormitory. And
well, so you recognize that Father Ryan was already integrated by then. My brothers had gone ahead of me, and so we didn't experience anything. There were several events. This is kind of interesting. To learn how prejudice, or I should say, to recognize how prejudice is learned. I mentioned taking the city bus, catching it in West End, headed east to downtown, and exchanging buses there. The bus would always stop at 21st and West End, right in front of the cathedral, for the elementary children to get on and whoever. I was sitting right behind the driver, you know, and the driver's, there's a three-person bench on either side. I was sitting on the bench behind the driver, space, and then the seat closest to the driver was also occupied. Young girl, probably in, I'd say, the second or third grade, got on the bus and came immediately after paying, sit right down next to me. She happened to be white. An elderly white woman, who was on the opposite side, three-person bench, got up, went to her, took her, and had her stand next to her for the rest of the ride. And I'm thinking, you know, here I am, and this is my junior year, senior year, and I'm thinking, and she, the young girl, had no idea what was going on, but she knew she needed to obey on some level. That's the tragedy of segregation, if you will. We weren't together, so we learned to live apart.
Mm-hmm. Very well said. Yes, sir.
Basketball defense. You said you played zone defense. Did you always play a zone, or just because of the dunk?
We mostly played zone.
We did. We were conditioned on the zone, and it was a zone that would drive most teams crazy, as well as our full court press. And I mean, I'm talking hours and hours on this thing. 1-3-1 and a 2-3 zone, and we would switch up just when they would get adjusted. If I, you know, get a couple of easy baskets, Derek, you know, call timeout, we'd switch, and then they're going, you know, it was just that element. That's what we did. Occasionally we would go man to man. My specialty was defense for the most part of my basketball time at Father Ryan, which I went from the freshman team all the way through. But we would run what they would call back in those days a box and one. And so I would be assigned to the best scorer. But we had a kind of a come to Jesus meeting. And I was not going to guard Perry Wallace. I was going to guard Walter Fisher. I wasn't going to guard anybody, pretty much. So I don't know if that had anything to do with his own decision or not. But the other thing, too, real quick, back to Fred Strobel's comments about this wasn't just a game that the two coaches got together and decided about. This was a process. This was going against the grain of the norm. So the principals, Father Hitchcock from Father Ryan and Mr. Holmes from
J.C. Hall,
Pearl, were all involved and had to get permission from, we were under the NIL, the National Interscholastic League, at that time. So this was quite a lengthy process. Took somewhat, I guess, a year, maybe a year or longer to actually put this thing together. And, of course, going to the auditorium, you know, of all places, so it was quite involved. We weren't involved in any of that. This was all behind the scenes. So, you know, again, it was just a set of circumstances where things happened, things fell in place. Maybe with the greater good, somebody knew down the line, we sure didn't, you know, what was really going on, so.
The audience segregated?
You mean, did they sit in separate parts? Or?
Yeah. I mean, if I look up in the audience, yeah, is all the blacks sitting there and all the whites sitting there?
There were probably patches of that, but you could see interspersed throughout the auditorium.
The question back here.
What was the process at Father Ryan that led to an integrated team? You said there hadn't been an integrated team, and then it changed. What was that process?
Well, I think it adds to your question, sir, and how did it all come about? Again, if you go back, 1954, I don't know if any of you remember this, there were black children. Well, the issue was, before the Supreme Court, separate but equal is unconstitutional. The black and white schools had been separate. And so because of that separation, and also because of funding, some black schools did not benefit as well as whites. Just the way it was. And so some parents, black parents, wanted their children to go to a better school and was denied the opportunity, so that case would go before the Supreme Court. 1954, the Supreme Court ruled separate but equal is unconstitutional. So we can't have separate races and they in fact be equal. And so it ruled that they had to bring about integration with all deliberate speed, and how that would be interpreted. It took a long time. It just took a time, but things were changing in the South slowly, with the integration of the school having minorities in all white schools now, began to put pressure on all the things that would bear, some of which was in sports. So it just eventually will get there. Does that answer your question?
So it began to happen just...
Yeah, it was immediate, Father Ryan. They integrated students. The student body became integrated. It wasn't a lot. There are not a lot of black Catholics in Nashville at the time. So, yeah. But those who went to high school would generally go to Father Ryan.
And so that season that things changed within the basketball team, do you remember, was there an announcement that you could all of a sudden try out for the team, or how did that part happen?
I don't know why I waited. I waited to my senior year, but again, Willie and Jesse Porter went out for the team immediately. Mm-hmm. So it was the opportunity presented to recruit.
And then both of you...
He was behind us. Yeah.
Both of you served in Vietnam. Correct? After your time at Father Ryan, and what was your experience like in the military in terms of race?
One of the things that was most problematic, I experienced a race riot while I was in Vietnam. And again, part of the problem is once you take away a common enemy, which would be the Viet Cong or North Vietnamese, if we had troubles if we brought troubles into the military from the way we were raised, then once you took that common enemy away, we became enemies. And there were a couple of those times. Uncle Sam recognized that there's no way you can win a war if your soldiers can't get along, and began in the early 70s to do an intense focus on and fixing of, if that was possible, of race relations. And in fact, by that time in 1975, I was sent to the Department of Labor, the Department of Defense Race Relations Institute. They had put a lot of money and time and energy. They were slow to move because in 1948, I believe, the armed forces was integrated. Well, it was 1948. 1975, it's like the early 70s, now they're going to fix this problem. But they got around to it, and they really put a lot of time and energy and money to make that happen.
Mm-hmm. About you?
We had a lot of issues because you have people from all over the country who looked at it in different ways depending on their environments. Black Panthers, Black Power. We saw that there would be in groups, but they were usually smaller groups, but they would specifically look for reasons to cause trouble. And the best thing we could do was just turn around and walk away. You might get hit in the back of the head occasionally, but that's what you did. Then others would eventually intervene and calm that situation down. And you might be, the officer or the NCO in charge, whoever. But as far as experience in the service, other than those times, and like you talk about, take away the common enemy, you were brothers, you watched their backs, they were watching your back. That's just the way it was. It came up through the same process, so that was just understood. Mm-hmm. But it was different people from different walks of life, so you were going to have people who were problematic, and a lot of times they didn't make it because of their attitudes. So.
Yes. I just wanted to mention one thing and see if you all can talk to it or maybe the Labor Girl can. Interesting, the connection that Coach Derrick and Coach Ridley established through this game. And it's interesting, in that particular time, I'm sure it was for you all the same way. You always thought your teachers were 50 years older than you. Coach Derrick and Coach Ridley were 33 years of age, same age as Martin Luther King Jr. at this particular point in time when they took this step. And the role that Coach Ridley and Pearl took in bringing this game about is as significant as the role Father Ryan took in that. There was risk on both sides of that, and a big step was being taken. And it's interesting that Coach Ridley and Coach Derrick's relationship became incredibly close as a result of that and lasted through the rest of their lives. And I'm curious about that part. You all knew the Pearl players from community center games, from pickup games, recess games. How that Pearl Ryan connection was established and how it was maintained. And maybe how it was felt on the Pearl, among the Pearl community.
I can give you an interesting perspective because I had lived in North Nashville the rest of Father Ryan, non-black, lived somewhere else. And so we played ball together, but we went separate places where we lived. And so I look back on that and you know, part of this 50th anniversary event was somewhat painful to recognize that I didn't really get to spend time with him except on the court because we lived in separate parts of the city, you know. And because of what was going on, there really wasn't much time together away from school or basketball. I would be drafted in 1969, and so that was a major separation. I came back for the 40th. High school reunion, I didn't recognize anybody. We'd all blown up. Again, just another tragic effect of segregation.
Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
I graduated 71 Hillsborough, and we had probably 6-7 black in our school, and that was sort of, you know, sure, moving to that expeditious high, what was the term you said?
All deliberate speed.
That's, yeah, right.
We did a year at a time.
Yeah, yeah. So, and that was, you know, a year of sort of experience and expectations, and I remember our basketball game with Pearl at Pearl, and there being tensions and some bus, yeah, shaking and some things like that, so it certainly wasn't terribly expeditious process, yeah, but we're still working on it, yeah, yeah, for sure.
We're still here, mm-hmm, unfortunately.
Yes, ma'am.
You had mentioned that there were, of the people in the audience, 8,000 of them were Pearl fans. I assume that's sort of an exaggeration. If that was the case, why weren't there as many people around? I mean,
Ryan was a very, very small school.
Just didn't have the best
in terms of attendance. Our, yeah, class in 65, we graduated with 526. We had one of the largest classes, uh-huh, for many, many years after to graduate. So it's a difference in the size. And quite honestly, I think everybody from Pearl, the Pearl backers and supporters and family members, this probably went back generations.
It does.
For some of them,
it still
to,
does,
to be there. Yeah, yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. Because of the history of the school. And they were just anticipating seeing a big old woman.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, and it was a.
We didn't get one.
Perry told me about the significance of this game too, and that there was no guarantee that there would be another chance to, yeah, play against a predominantly white school again. It had never been done before. there was no guarantee it would ever happen again. And so in talking to the Pearl players after they lost the game, extremely disappointed that there had been so much pressure on them to prove themselves and to win this game. And when it didn't happen, it was crushing. But I think they'll all tell you it motivated them the next year, where they go undefeated in the first integrated tournament and win that state championship. And so this Father Ryan loss sort of fueled that. I think we only have 1 minute left. So is there one last question from anyone? Yes, sir.
More of a comment. I graduated from high school in 1961 in Hobart, Indiana, which is a city on the southeast corner of Gary, Indiana. And reading the book, and I'm trying to think back what I was aware of and what I wasn't aware of relative to what was going on in the South. But we had competed cross-country, football, track, basketball, baseball, at least throughout northern Indiana, for sure. Just competed against each other, black, white. Gary had at least two integrated high schools. Gary Roosevelt, Gary Frable were major all-black powerhouse athletics. And it was, in reading the book, they were just bringing back, this is unreal, you know, what was going on.
Mm-hmm.
It seems like, you know, from a north to south, the further south you got, the worse it got.
Well, for sure.
In the book, you go down to the rabid racists of Mississippi.
Mm-hmm.
Went to Mississippi State, Ole Miss, and who are these people? You know, what comes out in the book.
Yeah.
So I was just looking back in my own mind, it's like, what I was aware of at the time, I don't necessarily recall, but comparing it to what I read in the book, it's just like,
well, I think even between Indiana and Tennessee, it was about 20 years. Tennessee was probably about 20 years behind. If you watch the Hoosiers movie, that Milan High School, they played a black school from Indianapolis, right, for the championship. And that was in the early 50s. And then the Big Ten had its first African-American player at Indiana in the 1940s. And the SEC is not until Perry comes along in the late 60s. So it was about the 20-year gap there. Okay, so we're out of time. Thank you. Next week, remember, we're thanks to these gentlemen too. Next week, the shuttles will take you over to the old Pearl High School. If you're going on your own, remember that's where we're meeting next week. It's the MLK Magnet School. And if anybody would like a book, I brought more copies again this week.
Oh yeah.